enough continuing weakness and fatigue that can last for a few weeks. The problem is that in a minority of cases, there is a biphasic illness, which means that the mild flu-like phase is then followed by apparent improvement. So the patient begins to feel that it's all over. And then only towards the end of the first week or the early second week of illness, there is worsening again. This second phase is caused by the body's exaggerated immune response in a process called cytokine storm. These patients can deteriorate to develop respiratory failure, and mortality rates are high in those that need ventilation. As I said in my second slide, COVID disease is largely similar to most viral pneumonias. This slide shows some of the features which are more prominent in or typical of COVID. These three epidemiological features enable high transmission rates. Now, the SARS-CoV-2 virus binds simultaneously to the nasal mucosa as well as the lungs. This is a distinction between SARS-CoV-2 and the other lethal coronaviruses, namely SARS and MERS, which bind mainly to the lower respiratory tract, to the lungs. This one binds to the nasal mucosa as well as to the lungs, and its incubation period is long. These two features gives a long window of opportunity for transmission, even before the symptoms of cough set in. As I said, this is in contrast to SARS and MERS, which could be contained quickly because the patient was mainly infectious only after the symptoms set in. Now, some clinical features which are more peculiar to COVID are loss of taste and smell. Now, loss of taste and smell is not unique to COVID, of course, but during the pandemic, if some patient tells me that I've lost taste and smell, I'm not going to think that it is a routine cold. We would suspect COVID as of today. Next is immune-mediated thrombosis, that is the formation of blood clots. The tendency for this is high in COVID. Now, the abnormalities in the lungs are of two types, and this needs to be taken into consideration in cases who need mechanical ventilation because their ventilatory prescriptions are different. Lastly, CT scan and autopsy studies are showing widespread clotting in lung vessels, which may cause sudden deaths. I have known of cases through my colleagues in the ICU. Of course, one needs to know that this is not sudden death, in patients who are absolutely fine. These are sudden deaths in the second week of illness. These are patients who are admitted, who are deteriorating, who are in the ICU and then seem to be recovering. And my friends tell me that, I just saw the patient 30 minutes ago, all parameters are normal, and sudden deterioration and cardiorespiratory arrest. So these kind of things are being observed with COVID. But the general public need not panic. This is not what is happening, at home or something like a cardiac, like a heart attack or anything like that. These are cases who have suffered the mild illness, who are in hospitals, and then this is happening. So in the setting of this pandemic, the clinical dictum should be that every acute fever be considered as COVID, unless proved otherwise. PCR test is done on a nasal swab sample and is typically positive from day 5 to 10 of illness. A positive PCR confirms, but a negative PCR does not rule out COVID. So it has good positive predictive value. Negative predictive value is not so high because 30 to 35 cases have false negative reports initially, and if you keep retesting, it may turn out to be positive later. Now, initially, you would have seen media reports of celebrities being detected positive for umpteen number of times. There were celebrities, every alternate day, the paper would say that celebrity is still positive. Now, the thing is that this virus particles may continue to be shed for 3 to 4 weeks and may result in a positive PCR. However, these patients are not likely to be infectious. Current guidelines do not recommend retesting except in seriously ill ICU cases or in research settings. Now, blood tests for antibody testing as of now is unreliable, and it has not been validated to correlate with protective immunity. We need to know which is the neutralizing antibody, and research is still on it. Now, imaging studies like X-ray and CT scans are able to pick up lung abnormalities even in mild cases and are being used quite often in clinical practice, even in patients without respiratory symptoms. So these are, I mean, we are using them as surrogate markers. Even before doing a PCR, a chest X-ray is easily available, do it. It is able to pick up very mild disease also. Now, as I said, in the second week of illness, the problem is with the body's own inflammation. And we do monitor inflammatory markers, which are blood tests, such as C-reactive protein, ferritin, D-dimer, and so on. And abnormal reports indicate that the patient is at a higher risk for complications. Now, this kind of a pattern of clinical severity is common to most epidemics. A majority of cases will have mild symptoms and recover without any medical intervention. So there is no need to panic. Only a fraction of those cases who need treatment, who need hospitalization, oxygen supplementation, etc., can suffer further complications and need organ support, ventilation, and so on. So majority of cases, there is no need to worry. Most people recover just like other flus. There is only this minority of cases that one has to be more careful of. And which are these people? These are those that are at higher risk of complications of COVID, include the elderly and those with pre-existing conditions, especially obesity, diabetes, hypertension, and immunocompromised states, like patients on dialysis, patients with liver cell failure, HIV, and so on. It's also been noted that males have a disproportionately high incidence of adverse outcomes as compared to females. Now, counterintuitively, those with asthma and respiratory allergies seem to have a survival advantage. It may be because of they have an underexpression of the ACE2 receptor, which is critical in the pathogenesis of COVID. So, most of our patients who keep getting upper respiratory allergies and cold coughs frequently throughout the year, they generally tend to panic more because they say that, doctor, anyway, I keep suffering this. I have allergies. I have this. I have 30 sneezes in the morning. I'm worried that I will get COVID. Now, for them, actually, as I said, it's counterintuitive. They actually seem to not suffer with it as badly as those who don't have these kind of problems. Now, when it comes to treatment, unfortunately, none of the drugs have shown any significant efficacy in controlling viral replication in the patients. Drugs that are directed towards controlling the exaggerated immune response seem to be able to improve outcomes. However, they need to be started at the right time and not too early in disease. So, in the hospital, primarily what is being offered is supportive care and treatment for hypoxia. So patients who have slight desaturation, normally our oxygen saturation, now everybody is aware, people have these pulse oximeters at home. Normally it is anywhere between 97 to 100. We classify COVID as moderate illness when the saturation drops to less than 94%. For these cases, and when saturation is even lower, then we need to treat hypoxia in various ways, from just oxygen supplementation by mask at one end of the spectrum and mechanical ventilation at the other end of the spectrum. Here you might have read reports that prone ventilation or prone awake proning, that means the patient is asked to lie on his belly. This seems to improve oxygenation. Of course, this is not unique to COVID again. This we have known for other pre-ARDS situations also. As I said, no FDA-approved drugs as of today. Recently, there was a trial that was published from UK on dexamethasone, and this improved the outcomes in ventilated patients. Now, dexamethasone is a freely available drug. I will make it a point to highlight here that this should not be misused. If people who are mildly ill take dexamethasone, this is going to probably worsen the outcomes because it is going to reduce your immunity and the ability to fight the virus. Initially, you need that. It is in the second week, in the minority of cases where their immune systems are hyper-responsive, that we may need to cut it and use drugs like dexamethasone and others to improve outcomes. Now, remdesivir is an antiviral drug which has been given the emergency use authorization, as the FDA calls it, because in one study called Act 2, it showed that it reduced duration of hospitalization, but it did not have any mortality benefit. Now, convalescent plasma, this is plasma that is taken from patients who have recovered from COVID. This can be used on what is called as expanded access or compassionate grounds to treat other cases. Now, hydroxychloroquine, you would have read, I mean, there's a lot of debate about it. As of now, large clinical trials are showing that it does not help in treating patients of COVID. So its EUA has been revoked. Its role in prophylaxis is, as of now, it is being continued. ICMR guidelines advise use of HCQ for healthcare professionals as far as prophylaxis is concerned. I'm not going to go into further details right here. If there are any questions pertaining to the clinical aspect, we can discuss this later during the Q&A. Now, coming to research and vaccine development, a whole host of clinical trials are underway, both to test antivirals as well as drugs to stem the cytokine storm, or the drugs that help to control inflammation. Some of these are global studies using multiple arms to test multiple treatment options simultaneously. However, nothing very encouraging so far to be excited about. Now, this is an interesting chart of positive strand RNA viruses, which SARS-CoV-2 belongs to. Now, positive strand RNA viruses, what they're able to do is that they're directly able to send messenger RNAs, for replication. So these are the positive strand RNAs. They do not require RNA-dependent RNA polymerase to convert into an mRNA. Because the idea is that virus uses the cell's own genetic machinery for replication. So positive strand RNA viruses do not have this intermediate step. They can directly be read by ribosomes for replication. So as is evident in the data, it suggests that the chance of developing a vaccine seem to be higher than finding an effective antiviral. As you can see here, polio, enterovirus, hepatitis A, and yellow fever. These are four positive strand RNA viruses which have vaccines, very effective vaccines. And only hepatitis C has an effective antiviral. Now, as far as COVID is concerned, there is some early proof of concept vaccine studies in monkeys which have shown positive results. And as regards antivirals, remdesivir is the only drug that has shown to give marginal benefit in terms of an early recovery, but at a high cost of treatment. Now, we still have some important unknowns when it comes to understanding the immune responses to COVID. Information which will determine the behavior of the pandemic and vaccine efficacy. Infections with other coronaviruses do result in immunity that lasts for 1 to 2 years. With COVID, it is too early to know. It is not very clear whether neutralizing antibody is going to be the key to protection, and if so, which antibody is to be tested. It is possible and it's most likely that it is a spike glycoprotein. But more data needs to come in on this. Cellular immunity, that is T cell immunity, may also play a role. And hence, if antibodies are not detected after a few months in recovered patients, they may still be immune to reinfection. And the answer to the third statement or the third question will determine if the pandemic will die out anytime soon. If the incidence of asymptomatic patients is high, and if asymptomatic or mild infection results in the development of protective immunity, then we are in luck. There is mixed data on this so far. In Iceland, they did population level studies and they find that perhaps 50% are infected. In India, in the hotspots, it was thought that around 20 to 25% are infected, while in other areas it is much lower. So we are not very clear on this so far. But if this is not true, then we are looking at a long haul. Despite all these unknowns, vaccine development research continues in parallel. Operation Warp Speed project of the United States aims at the fastest vaccine development in history. The current record holder is Ebola, which took 5 years, and traditionally it has taken decades. Some candidate vaccines are entering phase 3 trials, which are basically human trials on significantly large number of volunteers. And however, very many outcomes need to fall into place perfectly for a vaccine option to be available sometime in 2021. But I wouldn't bet on it. Also, there will be issues of scaling up manufacturing, stability during distribution, and then policy decisions on first use rights, such that they are fair and equitable. All in all, I think it will be a race between what happens first, vaccine development or the end of the pandemic. Now, understanding pandemic epidemiology is paramount in being able to deal with them better as a community. And I will try to highlight some important aspects here. Now, pandemics are basically epidemics with worldwide spread. The WHO declared the COVID-19 outbreak as a pandemic on the 11th of March, 2020. Pandemics are random freak events. Most of the recent pandemics have been zoonotic. That is from animal hosts. The virus comes from an animal host. What happens is that there's a mutation called antigenic shift in a virus while it is replicating in its zoonotic host. The mutation confers upon the virus the potential to jump species, be pathogenic to humans, and have the capability of human-to-human transmission. Once this happens and there is a chance exposure to that animal or bird, a human epidemic is triggered. Now, we need to realize that pandemics will continue to occur. They are not, in that sense, black swan events, a terminology popularized for the 2008 market crash. But rather, they are like a dangerous gray rhino. While we do not know when the next pandemic will occur, we are certain that it will. That these are extremely disruptive events is something that we can see only too well. So we've had 5 major pandemics in the last 100 years. The Spanish flu influenza epidemic of 1918 was an unimaginable disaster. We lost 6 times as many lives in the pandemic as in the World War I, which it coincided with. The important thing to note is that there were no containments or lockdowns then. If anything, information was contained because governments wanted to fight the war. Spain was neutral and had a free press. And so the reports came from there. Hence, erroneously, it was called the Spanish flu, although it never originated in Spain, nor did Spain suffer very badly with it. The first outbreak was possibly in Kansas, United States. Thereafter, we have had 3 smaller ones, smaller as compared to the Spanish flu, of course. And now COVID. So as you can see, COVID seems to be milder, and in a sense, it certainly is. However, please do factor in the lockdowns when you compare COVID with the Asian flu of 57 or the Hong Kong flu of 68 or the swine flu of 2009. Please factor in the lockdowns, which mathematical models estimate have reduced probably nearly 50 crore infections so far. And yet, in 6 months' time, we are at 10 million cases. Just 4 days ago, I think we reached there. And with 500,000 deaths so far. These other pandemics, mind you, lasted for anywhere between 1 to 2 years. So then when you compare COVID with the last three, not the Spanish flu, but with the last three, and you compare the number of cases and deaths, the naysayers will contend that COVID has been hyped. While the conspiracy theorists go to the extent to say that numbers are being inflated to enable vaccine development and profiteering. The simple fact is that they do not understand pandemic risks. While it is true that we are a global economy now with a 24/7 media, with much smaller families than before and resulting increase in value of life, and we expect to do better with modern medical facilities, it is probably also fair to say that as a society, we are less tolerant of disorder than a century ago. And it is also probably fair to say that if this were a low socioeconomic Asian African problem and not so much mortality in the high income developed world, it wouldn't probably get as much attention as it is today. Nonetheless, COVID is a clear and present danger, and we can downplay it at our own peril. Now, short explanation on these two basic epidemiological concepts. R naught indicates the number of persons an individual case is likely to infect on an average. It depends on virus biology, on the susceptibility of the population and social behavior. It is not a constant. Higher the R naught, higher the infectivity. When the R naught reduces to below one, that is one person is not even capable of infecting another, the epidemic will end. Case fatality rate is the ratio of the number of deaths from the infection to the confirmed cases expressed as a percentage. So you have the number of deaths in the numerator and the total confirmed cases of that infection in the denominator. So CFR depends on extent of testing and quality of data reporting. Generally, so you will have, basically you will have errors in this. So generally the error, the greater error is in the denominator, as the total number of infection can be in multiples of those detected. We are just not testing enough. The error in the counting of the number of deaths may only be caused by reporting errors and is not expected to be very large. Over time in an epidemic, more infections are diagnosed and hence CFR falls. Now, this is a very useful chart that helps us place COVID-19 in context with other infectious epidemics. And on this chart, you will find that this is a chart of the who's who of epidemiology when it comes to the various infections. So what we find is, so also note that the Y scale is, Y axis is log scale. So what we find that infections like MERS, Ebola and bird flu, which have a very high case fatality rate of around 35%, 50% and 55% respectively, have a lower rate of transmission. So transmission is on the X axis. It is simply a case of survival disadvantage for the patient and the virus both. On the other hand, have a look at chickenpox and measles, which are extremely contagious, but don't cause as much mortality. So there is an inverse relationship between R0 and CFR. There's a trade-off between pathogenicity and contagion. From a public health perspective, those viruses which are in a sweet spot of high transmission and moderate CFR are the ones that can cause dangerous pandemics. The two historical examples being smallpox with a CFR of a case fatality rate of around 30% and an R0 of nearly 5, and Spanish flu with a CFR of 10% and an R0 of around 2. After centuries of suffering with smallpox, we finally eradicated it with the vaccine. And with Spanish flu, thankfully, it hasn't returned after that deadly epidemic. COVID is still evolving, so the numbers are not very concrete. But it appears that the estimates of R0 are around 2.2, and the eventual CFR is expected to be lower than or around 1%. Waves refers to ebbs and flows that an epidemic can have as the virus encounters variably resistance or ease to run through the population, owing to factors such as climate, social behavior, population density, susceptibility, and local herd effects. Here we can see the deadly second wave of the Spanish flu, which killed as many people in 4 months as HIV did in nearly 20 years. That is the danger that a respiratory pandemic can bring. Now, herd immunity refers to the immunity of a population owing to the fact that a critical mass of the population is immune to the infection, thus rendering the spread of the virus through the susceptible individuals unviable. This immunity may be acquired through natural infection or by vaccination. In COVID, deciding to opt for herd immunity as a policy will be a brutal arithmetic disaster, as initially UK found out and now Sweden is probably realizing. Humans are not herds. So there is no option but to try and mitigate the pandemic and flatten the curve through lockdown. At the root of the rationale behind lockdowns lies an understanding of virus biology. Viruses are on the boundary of living and non-living. They cannot exist outside a living host for very long. They need the host cell genetic machinery to replicate and create new viral copies. So therefore, theoretically, if the entire human population can remain isolated for an adequate length of time, any epidemic will stop with a recovery of the majority and death of a minority of cases, depending on how, you know, how pathogenic the virus or the infection is. However, this utopian state is not possible. So all that we are able to achieve to a variable extent is to slow down the pandemic and use this time to enhance testing, detect and treat maximum number of cases possible, isolate the patients, quarantine the contacts, and ramp up the healthcare infrastructure facilities. Now, this slide is just an opinion, probably an extreme opinion in the context of public health policy. And I'm just throwing it here for more discussion and debate. We need to have national and global responses to outbreaks to stop us from being brought to our knees in such a manner in the future. The rationale is based on three facts. The first is that viral pandemics are definitely going to happen again. Second is that many pandemics have originated in China, Southeast Asia, or in any case, not in India. And the third is that once community level transmission of such infections sets in, it is very difficult to control them, as we are seeing now. So then perhaps it would make sense to have an algorithm in place wherein, if the prerequisites of a new viral outbreak causing respiratory disease and death are fulfilled, an international travel ban will be triggered. Basically, in a hyper-connected world, airlines are vectors of epidemics. Just the way our preventive intervention is focused on the mosquito in malaria, it perhaps needs to focus on airplanes in the settings of a respiratory outbreak. So to continue this idea further, this is just a representative illustration of the expected effects of such a policy. What may happen is that there will be times when such international travel bans will be triggered for insufficient reasons and lead to losses as shown as red events below the mean. As a hypothetical example, if such policies were in place, say since 2000, bans would have been triggered and would have been in retrospect exaggerated responses for SARS in 2002, swine flu in 2009, and MERS in 2012. However, given the unpredictably high nature of risks from pandemics, when the ban is triggered and is able to prevent something like COVID in 2020, the gains that it will bring will, in my opinion, far exceed all cumulative losses. Such a policy may position the state to benefit from convexity principles. That is, multiple small losses that a system is able to handle, and one blockbuster gain that makes losses look inconsequential. So now, when we come to risk and probability models and computing them, first a disclaimer, statistics is not my domain expertise, but I will try to explain as much as I have understood of it in the context of epidemics. Now, pandemics are stochastic domains. These are probabilistic counterparts to a deterministic system. Stochastic processes are characterized by random events, leading to an element of indeterminacy, even if the starting data point is known. Fat tail events are those where the tail determines the properties of the domain. In a sense, the tail wags the dog. Any data point in the body of the domain is insufficient to compute the properties of the domain, as the tail dominates the distribution. Take the example of a Gaussian distribution versus perhaps a Pareto 80-20. Now, Pareto was an Italian economist who showed that nearly 80% of land was owned by just 20% people, thereby showing that some domains have extreme values. Very few sets of data may be required to estimate the mean in a Gaussian, while nearly 10 raised to 13 times as much data points are needed to reach the mean in a Pareto. To cite another example, if we are calculating, let's say, mean incomes of, say, a lakh of people, and our sample size has reached say 99,900, and only we have 100 more people to sample. And if you have reached a mean income of let's say $5,000, in a Gaussian distribution, we have to assume that the other 100 are not going to change this much. But for a survey like an income survey, imagine people like Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, etc. in the other 100. They are going to skew the distribution entirely. So this is the point. In a nutshell, what this tells us is that it is very difficult to forecast what will happen in a pandemic. And in this context, I would urge you to read the works of people like Nassim Taleb, who forewarned us about such pandemics from the point of view of risk probability. And this cartoon pretty much sums up our understanding of estimation of probability in pandemics. I'm sure you must have got WhatsApp University, forwards and Gyan in January and early February, comparing the number of cases and deaths from dog bites versus COVID, or seasonal flu and COVID, or abortions and COVID, and how the world is making a big hype of COVID. Think of it this way. If you accept for a moment that COVID and dog bites or seasonal flu and abortions were equal in January and February, and we all slept for 5 months and woke up to read the newspaper on the 1st of July, and you find a headline that there are 10 million cases and 500,000 deaths from something in the last 5 months, what would you think is the more likely cause? COVID or dog bites? So leave alone the enormous economic hardships of a lockdown. This is the disproportionately high and difficult to quantify risk that a respiratory pandemic poses. Now, when we come to the Indian impact of these pandemics, Spanish flu impacted India very badly. Over 100 crore infections and a crore of deaths, with disproportionate loss of lives in lower socioeconomic group, with relative sparing of the rich, including the Britishers in India at that point of time. Thereafter, COVID is by far the worst that we have seen since independence, and the numbers are well known to all. I'll just focus on a couple of graphs. I'm not going into, there's so many graphs that are thrown at you every day. This is one graph, which I think is an important one, which shows that while testing has gone up, the percentage of positive cases per 100 tests continues to rise, which means that the epidemic is growing. Rate of rise of active cases is over 2% right now, and I believe it has increased over the last week, which means that we haven't reached the peak of the first wave yet. That will happen when the rate becomes zero. The saving grace for India is that the overall case fatality rate is much lower than world average. And while people tend to think that we have a better immune system, or that our weather is not conducive to the virus, or that BCG has helped, and so on, probably the most important reason seems to be that our median age is 27, which is much lower than Europe or US. And as I said earlier, the age seems to be one of the important factors in determining the adverse outcomes. Now, the Maharashtra story tells us that our state's test positive rate is 3 times that of the national average and is continuing to grow. Basically, it means that we're playing catch up with the pandemic. Dr. Mike Ryan, who has great experience handling Ebola outbreaks, makes some telling comments about pandemics in general. And I would like to quote him. Quote, "You need to react quickly. You need to go after the virus. Be the first mover. The virus will get you if you don't move quickly. If you need to be right before you move, you will never win in epidemics. Perfection is the enemy of the good. In epidemics, speed trumps perfection. However, the problem is that everyone is afraid of the consequences of error. But the greatest error is not to move, to be paralyzed by the fear of failure of the pandemic." Unquote. So we have to move ahead of the curve to be able to control the beast that COVID is. Now, some people have expressed their opinion that COVID is here to stay and that we will have to live with it. I think this view stems more from the fact that lockdowns cannot go on forever and is an attempt to state what seems to be a practical adjustment with what to them seems inevitable. In that sense, it is more motivational than scientific. However, history and science tells us that pandemics do not last forever. The pandemics in the last 100 years have lasted between 1 to 2 years each. The level of contagion and pathogenicity that COVID currently has will eventually subside. Whether the virus remains in circulation and keeps causing the few odd cases and some rare fatalities, or whether the epidemic will end completely, remains to be seen. Also, I do not think that we can live with it when it is causing as much havoc as it is today. I mean to say that I do not think that the viral pandemic and a normal life or economy can coexist. This is a false dichotomy. As an example, take the comparison of Sweden and Denmark, two Scandinavian neighbors. Sweden opted for herd immunity, Denmark for lockdowns. Today, Sweden has 5 times the per capita deaths as Denmark and a slowing of the economy to an equivalent extent. Therefore, I have no doubt that we will have to bring the pandemic in control before a sense of normalcy can be restored. And so I would say that neither will we have to live with, nor can we live with the COVID indefinitely. The only uncertainty is how long the current battle will have to continue. So now, what's the way forward? In my opinion, masks are a poor man's lockdown. And when I say poor, I'm not referring to India. The fact of the matter is that the whole world has been beggared by COVID. Prolonged lockdowns take a prohibitive toll on livelihood and cannot be continued indefinitely. Although purely from an epidemiological perspective, they make complete sense. The release of lockdown, unlock as it is being called here, will lead to a rise in cases. Masks will mitigate this. I'm of the opinion that not wearing masks in public should be made a penal offense during the pandemic. So the question arises as to which masks would be recommended. Most importantly, any mask is better than no mask. Here you can see the relative efficacy of masks in capturing virus-sized particles. The efficacy is expected to rise non-linearly if everybody wears masks. So again, you will benefit by convexity. If the extent of exposure is high, like in the case of healthcare professionals, N95 respirators would be advisable. For the others, a surgical mask or a cloth mask is fine. However, just wrapping up shawls or scarves, they are not going to be as useful. Just 2 days back, there's a paper that has come out to show that these kind of things like bandanas and scarves, they are not giving you the kind of protection that cloth masks would. So wear cloth mask at the least. Now, you have seen these naysayers, especially in the US, refusing to wear masks, claiming that it interferes with the breathing apparatus that God has given us, and such other outlandish reasons. Unfortunately, the media also tends to play up the comments and bites that such idiots give. They also go on to say that no clinical trial has shown efficacy of masks in COVID. My answer to such stupid arguments would be that absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. So please wear masks whenever you step outside. It is likely to bring substantial benefit at almost no cost. We must continue to follow social distancing norms. I am sadly dismayed to find that this has been reduced to a mere slogan. I know of people who work from home, but go to shop for groceries and vegetables every day. People who will have get-togethers with family and friends over the weekend. 10 people at tea stalls by the roadside, all with masks around their necks and drinking tea next to each other. Social distancing requires a discipline and a mental resolve for it to be practiced correctly. It means that you not only ensure physical distance, perhaps of 6 feet at least and more, but also see that within your work-life situation, it is as rarely needed for you to do so as is practically possible. I would think of it as reduced physical mobility. Try not to go out for trivial things. Try to have adequate provisions to last you for at least a week. I'm not saying holding, but at least a reasonable period of time, like a week. If you can work from home, do so for as long as is possible. And most importantly, remember to avoid super spreader events. Data shows us that these, and this is post-lockdown data, this shows us that these include weddings, funerals, religious congregations, bars, gyms, and home events. Viral transmission is far more common in closed spaces, far more common in closed spaces. Please keep these facts in mind. Now, while I don't like the terminology alternative medicine, within this group of therapies, I will restrict my comments to homeopathy alone. Homeopathy is a science where treatment is based on the pattern recognition of the symptom complex. It does not matter whether it is a known virus or a new outbreak, as the prescriptions are based on the study of symptoms and the pathology. Historically, homeopathy seems to have helped in the treatment of viral epidemics in the 19th and early 20th century. we find that it helps routinely in clinical practice in treating viral infections, that is in non-epidemic settings. Given this background, homeopathy being highly safe, very affordable, and compatible with standard medical treatment should, in my view, definitely be at the forefront of armamentarium against COVID. I agree wholeheartedly that more evidence-based research is needed in the same, and we must be careful when we make claims. Now, as far as supplements are concerned, there is mounting evidence that vitamin D deficiency may be a factor in adverse outcomes in COVID. So it makes sense to take vitamin supplements, including D, B complex, C, and zinc. Again, things that are likely to help with no downside risk. Please take it. So when it comes to hygiene and cleanliness, masks and protecting your face cannot be emphasized enough. Hand washing with soap and water is sufficient. Sanitizers are not required. I've seen people go crazy with sanitizers and getting skin conditions. Now about surface cleaning, we do not know the exact role of fomites in transmission. But my personal view is that if somebody is doing it in a non-obsessive but focused, disciplined manner, let us not ridicule such persons. Of course, as long as it is reasonable and is not going to harm anybody, because we've seen all kinds of outlandish ideas on this. Now, this seems to be the age of extreme reactions. On one hand, there are people who keep calling in panic because they think they have COVID. On the other hand, you see on television from time to time, large protests on themes such as masks are killers and so on. Unfortunately, a lot of this is fueled by the various media and WhatsApp universities. I know for a fact that plasma treatment trials could not recruit patients for some time in Pune because some TV channel reported irresponsibly that a patient died after receiving plasma transfusion. In the age of internet, there is a constant bombardment of all kinds of information, and unfortunately, sensational false ideas take center stage. I would urge all to be balanced and take appropriate precautions based on scientific data. Finally, to put things in perspective, this is not the end of the world. The plague and smallpox eras are over. Let us face this novel situation collectively, do the right things, and see this through. I have no doubt that great times are on the other side of this. I think that's all from my side. Thank you for a patient listening. And thank you, Professor Pandit, for inviting me.
Thank you, Amit. It was outstanding talk. And I leave the floor to question answers. May I request Ratnesh to monitor? I think it would be better if you just, whatever questions have been received,
yes,
put these questions one by one.
Yes.
As you feel, depending upon the availability of the time.
Yes.
You can, Dr. Habu can answer those.
Sure. So thank you, Dr. Habu. I'll be, raising certain questions here. And I would also request some of the question might need to be spelled out both in English as well as in Marathi, if that may be okay. For the wider category of audience which can understand the answer. So I'll go one.
Sure. Professor Pandit actually asked me to speak in Marathi and Hindi as well, but it was difficult to do that in the when I was talking about the scientific ideas. But I'm happy to interact in Hindi and Marathi for any questions that need to be answered right now.
Yeah.
Before I allow Ratnesh to start putting your questions.
Yes.
We might have a large number of questions. What I'll request Ratnesh to do, we'll send you questions by email. And at your leisure, you can answer them and send it back. Need not be completed.
Yeah, sure.
So that we can disseminate it to all the participants who have raised these particular questions.
Sure. So maybe what we can do on a lighter note, I can answer the easy ones now and the difficult ones by email.
True. Let me start with question number one. So the first question is there a pattern of the mild fever, like it comes in the evening or morning? Is there a pattern also in the mild fever, it goes up and down with respect to temperature, specifically to COVID-19 cases? Or it's
no, there is no such pattern.
Okay. What about autoimmune disease patients? So whether homeopathy whether COVID-19 has more, inclination towards autoimmune cases, or whether homeopathy is allowed in autoimmune cases also for COVID-19.
So I think there are two questions in this, as I understand it. The first is the effect of COVID on autoimmune conditions. Mm-hmm. And second is including homeopathy as a third variable. Do I understand it right?
Yes.
Right. So this is an interesting question because this the second week of COVID seems to be like an exaggerated immune response phenomenon. And therefore, it was thought whether autoimmune disorders may show this propensity more frequently. So far, there is insufficient data to say this. We would consider autoimmune disorders to be an additional comorbidity, like we do for diabetes, hypertension, and obesity. But nothing comes as close to probably advanced age. And second on the list would be obesity in conferring a risk on the patient. Autoimmune disorders do not seem to be doing as badly. Also, there are queries on treatment of autoimmune disorders. What should be done for people who do not have COVID but are taking treatment for pre-existing autoimmune conditions? Right now, the guideline is to continue that without change and to try and taper or reduce steroid as much as is possible. But the other drugs like hydroxychloroquine, methotrexate, and so on are recommended to be continued. Now, homeopathy, as far as homeopathy is concerned, if you're treating a chronic disease with homeopathy and the patient gets COVID, what happens is homeopathy understands this to be what will happen is that the chronic will probably get suspended for some time. So this is based on the theory of dissimilars. What happens is that when you have an acute, the chronic tends to get suspended for some time. So the focus will be on treating the acute. And we can go back to treating the chronic condition later after the COVID, after the patient recovers from COVID.
Okay, thank you. Second is this, if you could also answer in English and Marathi both. Whether homeopathy medicine help one to overcome COVID-19 in early stage? So probably the person is asking whether it can also be preventive. Or a septipatic patient can take homeopathy medicine and can be prevented from COVID-19.
Right. So, basically, homeoprophylaxis baddal haa prashna hai ki apan homeopathy treatment or homeopathic aushad adhipasun ghetla, tar aaple COVID honayche chances kami hotil ka, kiwa COVID zhala tar to milder hoil ka. Tar hyala uttar aata aaplyakade nahi hai, karan क्लिनिकल ट्रायल करत नाही तोपर्यंत वी कॅनॉट से दिस फॉर शुअर. पण हिस्टॉरिकली कसं द वे होमिओपॅथी हॅज अप्रोच एपिडेमिक्स इन द पास्ट इज की आपण एपिडेमिक मध्ये लेट से 15-20 पेशंट बघितले. बऱ्याचदा काय होतं की एका एपिडेमिक मध्ये सिम्पटम कॉम्प्लेक्स खूप सिमिलर असतो अँड देअरफोर द सेम होमिओपॅथिक मेडिसिन मे बी युज फॉर मल्टिपल पीपल. आणि जेव्हा आपल्याला वन्स यू आर कन्व्हिन्स्ड की बाबा हेच औषध जास्त करून लागू पडतंय इन अ मेजॉरिटी ऑफ केसेस, देन वी रेकमेंड द सेम, दिस वी कॉल एज जीनस एपिडेमिकस इन होमिओपॅथी. देन वी रेकमेंड द सेम टू बी टेकन बाय द जनरल पॉप्युलेशन विथ द एक्सपेक्टेशन दॅट द चान्स ऑफ गेटिंग दॅट इन्फेक्शन विल बी लोअर, ऑर जर तो झाला तरी तर ऍटलीस्ट माइल्डर होईल. पण दिस इज बेस्ड ऑन एक्सपिरियन्स, एक्सपेक्टेशन एटसेट्रा. म्हणजे दिस इज आय वुड कॉल एन ओपिनियन, नॉट एन एव्हिडन्स.
Okay, thank you. The next question is, what is the potential risk to kidney disease patients, especially those who have been administered with ACE2 receptor blockers like losartan for over 3 years?
So kidney disorders, madhe apan ACE2 receptor, is this to be answered in English or
Marathi? English will be okay.
Okay, so yeah. ACE2 receptors are used in kidney disease only till such time that creatinine is less than 3. After creatinine goes beyond 3, ACE2 inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers like losartan are contraindicated. So we don't use them in any case. So if you're asking me if patients who are on ACE2 inhibitors for, let's say, hypertension or mild kidney disease, they should be continued.
Okay.
There is no need to stop them.
Okay. Why asthma patient are at the low risk in the COVID? Is it right that asthma patient are at the low risk?
Yes, as one of my slides showed, this is a finding that asthma cases are not suffering. We don't have evidence to say that they're getting, that the chances of infection are lower. But there is evidence to say that the adverse outcomes are lower. So their mortalities are lower. And the probable reason is that patients with asthma or other respiratory allergies have lower expression of ACE2 receptors. So the receptor that the COVID, the SARS-CoV-2 virus binds to, is expressed lower in them. So they seem to suffer less.
Okay, thank you. The next question is, what is the role of blood group in COVID-19? Is there any particular blood group which is less infected or more infected? Do we have any evidence or any relation to the...
Not enough hard data to say this.
Okay.
There is some talk about this, but as of now, it's too premature to call it one way or the other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the second, this is an interesting question. It may be, given in both the languages. In India, we are not following the trend that more people are infected 60 plus year of age. We are actually having much younger population, which is getting infected. Lahan lokanna jasta hoto ekde COVID asa vatta hai ta data var. So, tumchi kay, tumcha opinion kay hai hachavar? Hachavar,
don't think goshti mani me. एक म्हणजे वी नीड टू रिअलाइज की आपलं मीडियन एज ऑफ इंडियन पॉप्युलेशन 27 आहे. ऍज अगेन्स्ट तुम्ही इटलीचं बघा तर मीडियन एज इज आय थिंक 43 का 44. युएस आहे इज अराउंड 37-38. सो आपल्याकडे पॉप्युलेशनच यंगर आहे. तसं तुम्ही बघाल की आफ्रिकामध्ये मीडियन एज ऑफ द आफ्रिकन कॉन्टिनेंट 19 आहे. सो नॅचरली त्यांच्याकडे आउटकम्स हॅव बीन बेटर. सो पूर्वीच्या एपिडेमिक्स मध्ये काय व्हायचं की लहान मुलं आणि म्हातारी माणसं बोथ वर ऍट रिस्क. कोविड मध्ये इट्स मोर दी एल्डरली. थँकफुली म्हणजे वन ऑफ दी आय थिंक आय फॉरगॉट टू मेन्शन दॅट ऑन वन ऑफ माय स्लाइड्स इज वन ऑफ दी गुड न्यूज अबाउट दी कोविड इज की चिल्ड्रन आर रिलेटिव्हली स्पेअर्ड. आहेत काही काही कंडिशन, एक इन्फ्लेमेटरी कंडिशन आहे जी लहान मुलांमध्ये पण बघितली जाते, पण इट्स व्हेरी रेअर. सो ती एक गोष्ट आहे की आपण ऍज अ पॉप्युलेशन आपण यंगर आहोत. आणि दुसरा इश्यू आहे डेटाचा, जो आय एम नॉट व्हेरी कन्व्हिन्स की आपला जो डेटा कलेक्टिंग प्रोसेसेस आहेत ते कितपत कम्पेरेबल आहेत विथ द रेस्ट ऑफ द वर्ल्ड. माय ओन फिलिंग इज की बाय द टाइम दिस पॅन्डेमिक इज ओव्हर, फॉर दॅट पर्टिक्युलर एज ग्रुप, म्हणजे आपण 60 वरचे जर लोक बघितले अँड वी कम्पेअर द इंडियन आउटकम टू द रेस्ट ऑफ द वर्ल्ड, my guess is that it will be same.
Okay.
Social distancing basis madhe pan elderly people didn't venture out much as much as the younger generation. So they
true. To ek factor hai. Ata cha tumhi America madla ata second wave nahi mhantay na tela, karan ajun first wave sampli nahi hai, pan ha jo resurgence mhantayil magche 2-3 aathvadyatla tyachya madhe America madhe baghitla jatay ki it is the younger people who are forming the bulk of patients magcha 2 aathvadyatle. So this is probably because they are venturing out, he sagale protest movements vagere je zale, the youngsters were out ani beaches var gele vagere ani elderly people are probably staying at home, but he kai far away rahnar nahi asa, karan the youngsters are going to go back and mingle with the elderly eventually, ani who knows in the next 2 weeks what we get to see as far as age distribution is concerned. त्यामुळे मला अगेन कमिंग बॅक टू फोरकास्टिंग, ह्याच्यामध्ये फोरकास्टिंग इज ऑलमोस्ट इम्पॉसिबल. त्यामुळे वन डझंट नो व्हॉट टू एक्सपेक्ट 2-4 आठवड्यानंतर. वी कॅनॉट जस्ट एक्स्ट्रापोलेट द ग्राफ्स अँड से की प्रोसेस अशीच राहील, कारण अमेरिकेमध्ये इट वॉज ऑन द डिक्लाइन टिल 2-3 वीक्स बॅक आणि आता परत तो वाढला आहे. सो वी नीड टू बी वेरी अबाउट इट ऑल द टाइम टिल इट इज ऍक्च्युअली ओव्हर.
दूसरा प्रश्न इस पे ये है कि हर्ड इम्यूनिटी क्या है? हर्ड इम्यूनिटी के बारे में आप थोड़ा और बता पाएंगे और कोविड 19 और हर्ड इम्यूनिटी का क्या रिलेशन?
सो हर्ड इम्यूनिटी ये कॉन्सेप्ट जो है वो अगर समझो 100,000 लोग हैं एक कम्युनिटी में, उनमें से 70,000 लोगों को अगर वो इन्फेक्शन हो चुका है या उन्होंने कोई वैक्सीन लिया है अगर मतलब कोविड के बारे में नहीं बट अदरवाइज अगर वैक्सीन लिया है तो क्या होता है कि मैथमेटिकल प्रोबेबिलिटी मॉडल ऐसा हो जाता है, और 70,000 ये एक एग्जांपल है, वो 80,000 भी हो सकता है, 60,000 भी हो सकता है, दैट डिपेंड्स कि वो उस वायरस का फैलने का रेट कितना है. सो ये 70,000 के एग्जांपल में मैं बता रहा हूँ कि अगर बाकी के जो 30,000 लोग हैं उनको मैथमेटिकल प्रोबेबिलिटी चांस ही इतना कम हो जाता है कि वो वायरस को उस कम्युनिटी, उस 1,00,000 पॉपुलेशन की कम्युनिटी में फैलना मुश्किल हो जाता है. और इस वजह से जो 30,000 लोग जिनका अगर हम टेस्टिंग करें इम्यूनिटी, इम्यून एंटीबॉडी का फॉर एग्जांपल, उनमें वो है नहीं, फिर भी उनको वो डिजीज होता नहीं है. ये हर्ड इम्यूनिटी का कॉन्सेप्ट ओरल पोलियो वैक्सीन में हम यूज करते हैं कि ये लाइव एटेन्यूएटेड वैक्सीन है. तो सफिशियंट नंबर ऑफ पॉपुलेशन को हमने वैक्सीनेट किया तो वी आर एबल टू सॉर्ट ऑफ एलिमिनेट द डिजीज. That is the concept of herd immunity. लेकिन कोविड में अगर हमने herd immunity allow किया as a policy कि जो होना है होने दो, तो क्या होगा कि शायद herd immunity हो सकता है. It is the expectation is that in COVID herd immunity will occur at around 70-80% of 70-80% of people are infected. But for discussion sake, let us say कि 50% पे हो जाता है हर्ड इम्यूनिटी कोविड में. तो वर्ल्ड पॉपुलेशन अभी 800 करोड़ है, उसमें से 400 करोड़ को इन्फेक्शन अगर होना है, और अगर मॉर्टेलिटी अगर लेट से 0.5% भी है तो वी आर लुकिंग एट 2 crore डेथ्स. तो इसलिए हर्ड इम्यूनिटी एज अ पॉलिसी नहीं होनी चाहिए. वी हैव टू मिटिगेट दिस. और क्या होता है कि अगर 2 crore पीपल आर गोइंग टू डाई इन अ मंथ, it is an unimaginable disaster. As against that, if we can pull this through for 2 years, ek to virus burnout bhi hota hai, there are many other things that can happen over time. So there are many, when you try to mitigate spread, it gives you time. It will give you time to look for better treatments. It will give time to hope for the virus to burn out. We may get a vaccine and so on. So allowing herd immunity to just rush through the population like UK did initially will always be disastrous for something that has got as high a mortality and as fast a spread as COVID.
Thank you. Yeah. So there are two additional questions on now vaccine side which are coming up.
Mm-hmm.
One is vaccine, what is the, probably you know everybody's asking question, how long it will take to come up a vaccine in the market for the patient.
Mm-hmm.
And a related question is the patient, those who are on again disease modifying therapies, autoimmune patient, whether they can take vaccine or they cannot because it contains the COVID gene.
No, as far as the second question is concerned, that will depend on what the findings are in the clinical trials with the vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
It depends on what kind of vaccine we are going to use. So right now we will not be able to say who will be able to take the vaccine and who won't.
Okay. The
I'd like to give you an example.
Yeah.
The yellow fever vaccine we need to take when we want to go to Africa. But there is a relative contraindication of using it in people above 65 years of age. So this we know after we know the properties of the yellow fever vaccine.
Yes.
So we will know about the properties of the COVID vaccine when it actually comes out, data comes out from clinical trials.
Okay. Thank you. The next question is again, if you could, you know, speak this in Marathi. So khub goshti ahe, steam inhalation ahe, herbal concoction ahe, Ayurvedic therapies ahe, je loka ghetat sathi. त्यांचे किती उपयोग आहे स्पेसिफिकली एनी कोविड पॉझिटिव्ह केसेस झालेले आहेत त्यांची फॅमिली मध्ये की त्यांचे ओळखी मध्ये त्यांचे उपयोग होणार की नाही होणार.
किती उपयोग आहे ते सांगता येणार नाही, पण जर जे काय करता आहे ते हार्मलेस आहे, ते वर्षानुवर्ष करत आला आहात किंवा इतर लोक करता आहेत, म्हणजे त्याचे बेसिकली डाऊनसाइड रिस्क काय जर नसेल तर जरूर करा. त्याच्यात किती बेनिफिट आहे आता वी कॅनॉट से.
अच्छा, आणि असा असा पण आहे की नेती केली की वायरस क्लीनिंग प्रोसेस मध्ये सपोर्ट होतो याचा याचे काय फॅक्च्युअल रिपोर्ट आहे की नेतीचे आपले हिस्टॉरिकल जे
जलनेती म्हणताय का
जल हां जलनेती
तो डॉक्टर धनंजय केळकर जे आहे दीनानाथ मंगेशकर हॉस्पिटलचे डायरेक्टर ते जलनेती स्वतः करायचे मागचे काही वर्ष कारण अपेरेंटली सर्दी वगैरे त्यांना व्हायची एक्सेट्रा आणि त्यांना त्याचे रिझल्ट चांगले आले त्या सर्दी बिर्दी करता तर ते सध्या स्टडी करतायत विथ डॉक्टर्स इन दीनानाथ मंगेशकर हॉस्पिटल तुम्ही कदाचित व्हॉट्सअप वर फॉरवर्ड पण आले असतील त्यांचे सो ते कदाचित डेटा पब्लिश करतील ते डेटा पब्लिश झाल्यानंतर आपण म्हणू शकू की त्याचा काही उपयोग होतो की नाही पण अशा ज्या गोष्टी आहेत ना की ज्यांनी काही तोटा होणार नाहीये तर ते तुम्हाला करायचं असेल तर जरूर करा त्यात काही हे नाही स्टीम घ्यायचं आहे एव्हिडन्स काही नाही आहे आता की स्टीम घेऊन हे होतं का चान्सेस कमी आहेत का पण व्हॉट एव्हर सीम्स लाईक माझी एक स्लाइड होती की व्हॉट एव्हर सीम्स रिझनेबल ज्याच्यानी काही डाऊनसाइड रिस्क नाही आहे जे कॉस्टली नाही आहे म्हणजे कुठलं तरी भयानक कॉस्टली नॉव्हल ट्रीटमेंट अनटेस्टेड ज्याला काही त्याचे काही रिस्क माहित नाही त्याचे साईड इफेक्ट आहेत की नाही माहित नाही असं करू नका पण बाकी हे सगळे गोष्टी करायला काही हरकत नाही जलनेतीचं त्यांच्याकडनं काय डेटा येतोय बघायचा ते त्यांचं म्हणणं आहे की काहीतरी 600 डॉक्टर्स त्या आय थिंक फॉर्मल ट्रायलच आहे वाटतं ती ते कारण ते एक्सपोज आहेत ना लोक सो इट इज अ कंट्रोल्ड सेटिंग की त्या हॉस्पिटलमधल्या डॉक्टर्सचा इन्सिडन्स काय आहे दे मे बी प्रॉब्ली बी एबल टू कम्पेअर विथ अदर हे का विदिन देअर स्टडी इट सेल्फ त्यांचे दोन ग्रुप्स असतील की जे करतायत जलनेती आणि नाही करत आहेत मला डिटेल्स माहित नाही त्याचे पण आय बिलीव्ह ते त्यांचा स्टडी पब्लिश करणार आहे पण ते येईपर्यंत कदाचित पॅन्डेमिक संपेल कुठवर होईल आपल्याला माहित नाही त्यामुळे ज्या लोकांना करायचं आहे आता ते जरूर करा
अजून लास्ट दोन क्वेश्चन ऍक्च्युअली क्वेश्चन खूप आहे मी दोन क्वेश्चन विचारतो फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन आहे आर्सेनिक अल्बम खूप फेमस पण झालेला आहे लोकांनी घेतलेला पण आहे ऍक्च्युअल इफेक्ट काय आहे ह्याचा आणि सेकंड वेगळी वेगळी लोकांना अजून पण डिसीज आहे हार्ट डिसीज आहे रुमेटॉइड आर्थरायटिस आहे ब्लड प्रेशर आहे ते अजून पण मेडिसिन घेतात त्याचे बरोबर आर्सेनिक अल्बम घेतला की काय प्रॉब्लेम होते की आर्सेनिक अल्बमची साईड रिएक्शन आहे का कुठली तरी अजून औषधवर असा काय आहे का तुमच्याकडे काय ओपिनियन आहे ह्याच्यावर
आर्सेनिक अल्बम दुसऱ्या कुठल्याही अलोपॅथिक औषधाबरोबर किंवा दुसऱ्या कुठल्याही मेडिकल कंडिशन मध्ये घ्यायला परफेक्टली सेफ आहे त्याचा काही इश्यू नाही आहे कारण आपण 30 पोटन्सी मध्ये घेतो त्याच्यामध्ये मटेरियल डोज आय मीन चान्स ऑफ फाइंडिंग अ मॉलिक्यूल इन 30 पोटन्सी इज हायली नेग्लिजिबल सो डाऊनसाइड रिस्क काही नाही आहे साईड इफेक्ट प्रोफाईल सेफ आहे आणि दुसऱ्या कुठल्याही अलोपॅथिक औषध किंवा मेडिकल कंडिशन मध्ये घ्यायला काही प्रॉब्लेम नाही नाव ते त्याचा उपयोग कितपत आहे अगेन लाईक अ सेड हे एक अनटेस्टेड सिच्युएशन आहे आपल्याकडे काही डेटा नाही आहे सांगायला की बाबा इतके टक्के बेनिफिट आहे प्रोफिलॅक्सिसच्या रोलमध्ये किंवा इतके टक्के बेनिफिट आहे ट्रीटमेंटच्या रोलमध्ये जसं मी मगाशी म्हटलं की होमिओपॅथीमध्ये आपण कसं अप्रोच करतो की सिम्पटम कॉम्प्लेक्स स्टडी करून एक औषध निवडतो आणि ते पेशंट्सला देतो आणि जेव्हा पेशंटना गुण येतो तेव्हा आपण म्हणतो की तेच औषध तुम्ही प्रोफिलॅक्सिस म्हणून वापरा सो दॅट इज द आयडिया बिहाइंड इट हे आयुष मिनिस्ट्रीने रेकमेंड केलेलं आहे कारण त्यांनी स्टडी केलं कोविडचे सिम्पटम्स आणि हे पर्टिक्युलर हे रेकमेंड केलंय पण ह्याच बरोबर बाकी होमिओपॅथचाही काही ओपिनियन्स आहेत काही एक्सपिरियन्सेस आहेत ते इव्हेंच्युअली जोपर्यंत आपण म्हणजे हा सगळा ओपिनियन बेस्ड आहे ह्याला काही हार्ड एव्हिडन्स अजून आला नाहीये आम्ही स्वतः माझ्या वडिलांचं काही ओपिनियन आहे जे आम्ही ऍक्च्युअल फॉर्मल क्लिनिकल ट्रायल मध्ये हे करणार आहोत आता पण ह्या सगळ्याला वेळ लागतो एथिक्स कमिटी अप्रुव्हल लागतात ऍक्च्युअल टेस्टिंग व्हायला लागतं सो डेटा यायला वेळ लागतो सो एपिडेमिक सिच्युएशन मध्ये इतकी फास्ट मुव्हिंग असते की त्या एपिडेमिक मध्ये केलेला डेटा त्याच वेव्ह मध्ये किंवा पुढच्या वेव्ह मध्ये वापरता येईल का पुढे कधी ही झाली तर आपण तेव्हा वापरू शकू अशी बऱ्याचदा हे होते त्यामुळे वॅक्सिन सुद्धा आतापर्यंत कधीही असं घडलं नाहीये की एपिडेमिक सुरू झाला आणि त्याच एपिडेमिक मध्ये नवीन व्हायरसचा एपिडेमिक सुरू झाला आणि त्याच एपिडेमिक मध्ये पहिल्याच याच्यामध्ये आपण वॅक्सिनेशननी हे केले वेअर वी आर एबल टू गेट सक्सेस असं कधी झालेलं नाही सो कोविडच्या बाबतीत जर झालं पुढच्या वर्षी तर इट विल बी द फर्स्ट
ओके थैंक यू. हे क्वेश्चन आहे अजून वेळ असली की आपण एखाद आई मीन तुम्हाला तुम्हाला वेळ असली की एक अजून मी विचारतो पण हे लास्ट क्वेश्चन आहे आत्तासाठी.
Sure. की
खूप दिवस झाले सगळी घरी बसलेली आहे, लोकांची इम्युनिटी वेगळी वेगळी आहे, ते बाहेर जाताना आता चालू काय काय गोष्टी चालू पण झालेली आहे, स्पेसिफिकली किड्स दे हॅव नॉट बीन गॉन आउट, तर आता काय आहे की त्यांची इम्युनिटीवर इम्पॅक्ट येणार काय, ते घरी बसलेले आहे, नॉर्मल एन्व्हायरमेंटल कंडिशन आता प्युअर पण झालेली आहे, हवा पण प्युअर आहे, तर त्यांची इम्युनिटी आपले नॉर्मली मुंबई सारखा सिटी असली की इम्युनिटी स्ट्रॉंग होते काय, एक्सपोजर ज्यादा जास्ती असतो, तर आता हळूहळू अनलॉकची प्रक्रिया चालू झालेली आहे, घरी जाणार ते कसा करायचा, की काय स्टेप आहे, काय रिकमेंडेशन आहे की हळूहळू आपण कसा एक्सपोज होणार, काय इम्युनिटीवर जे इम्पॅक्ट आहे की 3 महिने घरी बसले की इम्युनिटी कमी झालेली आहे असा असतो का, की असा नाही आहे की 3 महिन्यामध्ये काय इम्युनिटीवर इम्पॅक्ट नाही येणार, तुमची काय रिकमेंडेशन आहे हळूहळू नॉर्मल लाईफ चालू कसा होऊ शकणार आहे.
माझ्या स्वतःच्या रिस्क बेनिफिट अनालिसिस असं राहील की घरी बसण्याने जर काही थिओरिटिकल रिस्क असेल की बाबा उन्हाचं एक्सपोजर कमी झालं, सो व्हिटॅमिन डी कमी झालं म्हणा किंवा व्हॉट एव्हर इट इज, बाहेरची फ्रेश एअर नाही मिळाली आणि जे काही इम्युन सिस्टीमवर परिणाम होत असतील, म्हणजे आपल्याला माहित नाहीये की होतात का 1-2 महिन्याच्या ह्याच्यात किंवा 4-6 महिन्याच्या ह्याच्यात, ठीक आहे अग्रीड की जर कोणी वर्षानुवर्ष कोणी कोंडून राहिलं वगैरे तर असे होत असू शकतील, पण आत्ताच्या काळामध्ये हे रिस्क बेनिफिट इव्हॅल्युएशन माझं तरी असं राहील की घरी राहण्याला काही प्रॉब्लेम नाहीये, बाहेर जाऊन कोविडची रिस्क लहान मुलांनी घेणार त्यांना काही होणार नाही, पण ते घरी परत येतील, तेव्हा आजी आजोबा असतील त्यांना ते पसरणार आणि ती रिस्क सबस्टॅन्शियल आहे, त्यामुळे मी ही रिस्क पत्करायच्या फेवर मध्ये आहे की जर काही घरी राहून काही बाबा काही काळ थोडा इम्युन लेवल्स कमी झाले तर हरकत नाही, पण उगीच इम्युनिटी वाढण्याकरता आता लोक जात आहेत, म्हणजे आपल्याला ह्याच्यात बघायला मिळतं पेपरामध्ये किंवा मीडियामध्ये की कुठे मरीन ड्राइव्हर होता, आय डोंट नो ते खरे असतात की नाही तेही माहित नाही आपल्याला रिपोर्ट, पण इतके लोक वॉकिंग करतायत नेक्स्ट टू इच अदर, काही गरजच नाही आत्ताच्या ह्याच्यात करायचं हे सगळं, वॉकिंग करायचं, एक्सरसाइज करायचं घरी पण करू शकता, गच्चीत करा, कंपाऊंड असेल तिकडे करा, पण असे पब्लिक ह्याच्यामध्ये जाऊन, कारण अमेरिकेसारखं नाही, अमेरिकेमध्ये काय एका फुटपाथवर एक चालत असतो तर दुसरा माणूस दुसऱ्या फुटपाथवर असतो, आपल्याला ते तसे ऍडव्हान्टेजेस नाही आहे, त्यामुळे उगीच वॉकिंग करण्याकरता रनिंग करण्याकरता, मग रनिंग करायचंय तर मास्क घालून नाही करता येत कारण श्वास घ्यायला डिफिकल्ट होतो, त्यामुळे विदाउट मास्क किंवा गळ्यात मास्क घालून रनिंग करणं, मग कोणतरी शेजारून जातं, हे सगळे बिहेवियर इन माय व्ह्यू इनडिसिप्लिन बिहेवियर आहे आणि ते आता करू नये, जी काही मायनर हे असेल की इम्युनिटी थोडी ड्रॉप झाली वगैरे ते आपण सगळे रिकव्हर करू नंतर, आता द इम्पॉर्टंट थिंग इज टू लिमिट द नंबर ऑफ पीपल गेटिंग कोविड.
ओके थँक्यू, आय थिंक दॅट वॉज नाईस, सो आय एम जस्ट टेकिंग देर आर लॉट ऑफ क्वेश्चन, आय विल सेंड इट टू यू ओव्हर द ईमेल आय वुड से, लास्ट क्वेश्चन काही इम्पॉर्टंट आहे लोकांसाठी, की खूप सामान आता बाहेरून होम डिलिव्हरी करून लोक सामान घेतात, ग्रोसरी येतात, व्हेजिटेबल येतात, खूप सामान येतात, तर त्याचे काय प्रिकॉशन्स आहे एक्झॅक्टली, त्याच्यावर व्हायरस असतो किती असतो, त्याला टच केला त्याला ठेवायच्या बाहेर 4-5 तास, काय आहे एक्झॅक्टली तुमचे रिकमेंडेशन त्याच्यावर.
आता ह्याच्यात फोमाइट्स म्हणतात इनॅनिमेट ऑब्जेक्ट्स ज्याच्यावर व्हायरस असू शकतो आणि जो आपण त्याला हात लावला आणि मग नंतर आपला हात आपल्या तोंडाशी नाकाशी नेला तर आपल्याला इन्फेक्शन होऊ शकतं, हा त्याच्यामागचा कॉन्सेप्ट आहे. कोविडच्या बाबतीत आपल्याला माहित नाही एक्झॅक्टली किती ह्याची रिस्क आहे, पण आता तरी आपण असं गृहित समजू की आहे ह्याच्यात रिस्क, तर जे आपले जनरल प्रिकॉशन असतात, आता भाज्या घेऊन आलं तर नीट धुवून घ्यायचे आणि एकदा त्या ऑब्जेक्टची कॉन्टॅक्ट आपण केल्यानंतर आपण वन्स दॅट कॉन्टॅक्ट इज ओव्हर आपण पहिले जाऊन सोप वॉटरने हात धुवून टाकायचा. ह्या व्हायरसला एक लिपिड बायलेअर आहे, म्हणजे एन्कॅप्सुलेटेड व्हायरस आहे विथ लिपिड बायलेअर, ते सोप आणि वॉटर मध्ये इमिजिएटली डिस्ट्रॉय होऊन जातं. सो काय म्हणजे अॅटम बॉम्ब घरी आणल्यासारखं वागायची गरज नाहीये, पण सो यू जस्ट फॉलो इन अ डिसिप्लिन वे. काय होतं प्रॉब्लेम काय होतो की लोक हे 5 दिवस 10 दिवस 15 दिवस करू शकतात आणि नंतर काहीही करायला लागतात, मग सो जसं मी म्हटलं की आय नो पीपल की जे वर्क फ्रॉम होम दिलाय त्यांना पण ते रोज जातात बाहेर संध्याकाळी. सो असं जर झालं तर हे आपण काही वी वॉन्ट बी क्लोज टू द एंड ऑफ द पॅन्डेमिक एनी टाइम सून. इफ पीपल कॅन बिहेव इन अ डिसिप्लिन फोकस्ड वे फॉर एज लॉंग एज इज पॉसिबल देन वी विल बी एबल टू सी द एंड सूनर. बिकॉज लॉकडाउन्स आई मीन लॉकडाउन बियॉन्ड अ पर्टिक्युलर पीरियड ऑफ टाइम आर गोइंग टू बी काउंटर प्रोडक्टिव. त्यामुळे आपल्याला नॉर्मलसी टू सम एक्सटेंट रिझ्युम करायला लागेल. नेव्हरदलेस आपण हे जर सगळे प्रोसेसेस हे नाही केले तर जास्त केसेस होतील, जास्त ऍडमिशन होतील. आणि मग मी सॉरी मग मी अशा लोकांना म्हणतो की तुम्ही स्वतः ती लोक जी टाळ्या वाजवायला आला म्हणा डॉक्टरांकरता वगैरे वगैरे आणि आता तुम्हीच जाऊन बाहेर जाऊन चहा पीत बसणार आहात टपरीवर, जास्त इन्फेक्शन करणार आहात, मोर डॉक्टर्स विल गेट एक्सपोज इन हॉस्पिटल. तुम्हाला तर त्रास होईलच, पण तुम्ही तुमची जर अशी मनाची इच्छा होती की लोकांनी डॉक्टर्सनी पण इन्फेक्ट होऊ नये एक्सेट्रा, तुम्ही सपोर्ट मध्ये आलात तर हा सपोर्ट नाही आता असं हे करणं. सो बेसिकली डिसिप्लिन अँड नोईंग सर्टन थिंग्स की क्लोज स्पेसेस मध्ये ट्रान्समिशन जास्त आहे तर तुम्हाला वॉक करायचं गच्चीत जा नो प्रॉब्लेम, पण तुम्ही क्राऊडेड एरियाज मध्ये जाणार असलात बाहेर तर इट इज गोइंग टू बी ट्रबल.
अनम्यूट युअर सेल्फ रत्नेश.
थँक्यू डॉक्टर हब्बू. It was very informative and I think people must have benefited from your recommendation and suggestions. I must say that it was very very informative to all the participants, and I'm continuously receiving questions as well as feedback on this particular lecture. Sir, would you like to say anything before I just say what of things?
Yes, I would. First of all, I would like to profusely thank Dr. Amit Abbu. खूप खूप धन्यवाद. आणि तुम्ही शेवटचं जे म्हणालात ते व्हॉट्सअप युनिव्हर्सिटीमध्ये त्याच्या रिलेटेड एक छान कार्टून आलं होतं की ज्या वेळेला कोविड होतो तेव्हा यू लूज अ सेन्स ऑफ स्मेल अँड टेस्ट, व्हॉट हॅपन्स टू कॉमन सेन्स. त्याला उत्तर दिलेलं होतं की कॉमन सेन्स डझंट गेट अफेक्टेड बट लुझिंग दॅट ऑर नॉट युझिंग इट इज अ रिझन वाय यू गॉट कोविड. So what you have just said correctly depicts, and it is extremely informative, and the lecture which you gave has resolved many of the issues or the queries which people had. And this lecture is going to be available on YouTube. It has been recorded with your permission, and once we get complete answers to all the questions after email, maybe we can use that as a supplementary mode as well and make that as a template to make it available to a larger population as an ICT initiative with your help. Thank you very much again, and I much appreciate your time and efforts in putting all this information together.
Thanks for the invitation and this opportunity.
Yeah, so I just wish to thank Institute of Chemical Technology, Professor A.B. Pandit, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Deshmukh, Registrar, and Professor Padma Devarajan, head of our TechCube, to support this particular seminar. I also thank all the participants who has taken out to interact with us, and thank you all for having a great participation. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.